Cuidado, señor Tirino. ¡Traigan los caballos acá! ¡Adelante!
Santana found these men hiding in the barracks.
General Castrillon, are you hard of hearing?
Mi general, the battle is over.
They're going to kill us.
Peloton, take them to the war.
Formation! Preparen! Apunten!
Death to you bastard!
You got a black coward?
We found the bodies of the ones in charge, Travis and Jim Bowie. I've let the women and children leave. There's no point in their seeing us.
Seguin. What about Seguin? I want Seguin.
¡Viva Texas Libre!
Fuego! Get me Seguin.
¡Alto!
Santana.
Juan, we did the best we could.
We should have left earlier.
I shall never forget the fall of the Alamo. It has haunted me for many years. Tejano friends died there. Esparza, Lozoya, Fuentes. Names perhaps not as familiar as Bowie, Travis, or Crockett. Yet they were defenders of Texas also. A native of San Antonio de Bejar, I find myself now persecuted, a stranger in my own land, a land I fought to defend. But it was not always this way. In the beginning, San Antonio was a small settlement in the northern territory of Mexico, known as Texas. I lived nearby with my family at Casablanca. It was the summer of my 17th year, 1821.
Well.
Your father? Is the two's bringing Americanos from the east?
Yes, yes, they're coming this afternoon.
My poor bottom, Quevaro. The way this man drives, you'd think we were being chased by Comanches.
Come on, Antonia. You know I make no promises when you ride with me. You should be grateful we have to ride at all.
Trudy, hija, bring the things. Come on, bring the things. A ver, comadre, platíquenme.
Antonia.
Antonia.
senor. Let me help you with that.
Cruz Arrota. How are you, young man?
Bien, senor. I'll take them to the stable.
Thank you. You're a good man.
I can assure you my neighbors will give you a warm Tejano welcome, Mr. Austin.
No more Mr. Austin. Esteban. That is how they say it in Spanish, is it not?
Very well, Esteban, it is. You mustn't think that we're safe from Comanches here because we're close to the ranch. All of Tejas is not like this, eh, Martin?
What Don Erasmo says is true. We recently made a treaty with the Comanches of this region, but that treaty is not always very secure, especially if a hard winter hits and the Indios are starving.
Ooh. We have a saying, Esteban. Amigo sin camisa, cuidado con su risa. Means, you must be careful of your friends when you are well fed and they are not.
Well, that I can understand. But if the governor will go along with my plan to settle along the Colorado, I plan to bring in 300 families. And surely 300 families ought to be enough to discourage the local Indians.
If those 300 familias behave themselves.
That they will, I can assure you. The key, gentlemen, is to get the governor's permission.
Y con el favor de Dios.
In addition to God's help, Esteban, Don Erasmo and myself will do the very best we can to secure a favorable arrangement from the governor for you.
Buenos amigos. Now that I can remember.
Perfecto. Buenos amigos.
Buenos amigos.
Little did my father realize how these Americanos would come to affect our lives.
Muy bien.
The Americanos shared with us their long shooting rifle, and we offered them Tejano hospitality.
Who is this man? Erasmo says he's a very good man.
I see.
He wants to bring people to settle here in Texas.
I see people, eh? What kind of people come?
Americano.
You look over this borehole, gauge wind, and real careful like.
Very good.
You clean it 100 yards.
Like that one over there?
Yeah, I declare.
Juanito, let's see you try.
My pleasure, Don Antonio.
You see, Esteban, Mexico is now independent. So we must protect our northern frontier.
Yes. We have spoken with Governor Martinez several times in this regard. And he has told us that he is not opposed to colonists from the United States. But they must obey the law of our land.
Well, that is only to be expected.
What Erasmo is getting at is that you might find some of our traditions difficult for you people to accept.
Then I have trouble understanding your meaning, Don Erasmo.
Well, Esteban, for example, among our laws is one which holds that all citizens must profess the religion of the Holy Church of God.
Any colonists I bring in here must agree to respect these laws.
I welcome, Martin.
No.
people that you are bringing to Tejas. Now, we know that they're not pagans, but they're not Catholics.
Another tradition, Mr. Austin, is that there has never been slavery in Tejas.
Juan, por favor. Mm. Mr. Austin is our guest here.
The young man does have a right to speak his mind. Now, I am a God-fearing man, and I will come to worship the God of your holy church. This question of slavery is a question of property. Mr. Austin, even if we assume for the sake of argument that slavery is indeed a question of property, do you see the need for it here in the wilderness?
My son has a point. Slavery is not our way of doing things here.
Do not confuse poetry with the necessities of life. We all know that Tejas is fertile, capable of growing all crops, and most certainly, cotton.
Now that is my thinking entirely, Don Martin. Cotton is what will make Texas grow.
And cotton, Don Erasmo, means slaves, like it or not.
Well, I don't like it. And with all due respect, sir, Tejas can grow quite well without bringing this abomination against humanity into our lives.
I give you my word on this, Esteban. I will intercede on your behalf in any way that I can to assure that your colonists find a warm welcome here in Tejas. Learn our language, hombre. Learn our customs. Join in our way of life out here. Why don't we build a new world together out of this God-given wilderness, huh?
With all my honor, with all the power I have, I will respect the laws of this republic. And I will work with you, gentlemen, to create this society of which you speak.
Tejas or Tejanos?
Tejas or Tejanos.
Un abrazo.
Un abrazo. When the hammer hits it, it blows up.
Tejas or Tejanos. Antonio, my young lion has another side.
Our children are growing up.
See, you look deep down the barrel. Just pull that hammer. Pull that hammer. The Americanos had left an impression on us, which Manuel Flores never tired of recounting to our neighbors, Gregorio Esparza and his brother Francisco. All of us were unsuspecting of the Americano presence, which would one day divide brother against brother. And I was confronted once again with the question of slavery. Slave. Look at his feet.
The
The settlers are awaiting our good news.
Father?
Mm-hmm.
What? I wanted to speak with you.
What? What is it?
It's about the colonists.
Well, speak, sir. We have no secrets from our friend.
You taught me that all men are equal. All men. Now, if that is so, how can you condone the colonists bringing in slaves?
The young man who took my horse today, Cruz
Arrocha.
Is he a member of your family?
His family died of the cholera. We took him in as a child.
Does he own land around here?
No.
But you pay him for his work.
He lives here. We feed him.
Does he sit and make decisions with you and your father? But he does the work that you order him. He has no say in that. No, Juan. He is a peon. He lives by your command. How is this different from our slaves?
Without colonists, the Haskins cannot grow. And without growth, we'll never become a state of the Republic.
Juan, about last night, you are entitled to your beliefs.
You taught me something, Mr. Austin. I'm grateful. Your horse is ready.
Within a few months, the first Americano families began to arrive. The compromise my father had made in allowing the Americanos to bring their slaves with them forced me to consider my relationship with Cruz Arrocha.
Wait. From now on, I'll do it.
It's the colonists.
Look at the richness of our land. It should be rich for all men.
And women.
And women? Father says that with all the settlers coming, they'll have to declare Tejas a state soon. But I wonder what it is we're building here with slaves and peons.
You can't change the whole world.
I can change my world.
Gertrudis and I were married on January 18, 1826. My father presented us with 500 acres of land as a wedding gift. We agreed that Cruz would own the land with us. We would work and harvest the land together. Soon, Cruz would be godfather to our child. A son, Juan Nepomuceno Seguin, the second. Meanwhile, Cruz Arrocha was also discovering life.
Anastasia, it's so hard for me to tell you. I think you're wonderful. No, I know we've only known each other for a short time, but... Anastasia, I love you.
I love you too, Cruz.
Juan, you've got to help me. I'm in love. She's beautiful. I mean, she's the most beautiful woman I've ever met.
So?
I don't know how to tell her. I mean, she's so beautiful. What if she doesn't like me?
Well, Cruz, you got to tell her, because if you don't, then she won't know how you feel about her.
That's true. Maybe she does like me.
Of course she likes you. Remember, there's no accounting for taste.
The present you gave her very much.
Did she really? Oh, I almost forgot. This is for you.
Oh. Gracias. Oh. It's beautiful, huh? What is it for?
Well, it's a mask. I made it myself. It's for you. Look. Anastasia, I have to tell you that I love you. I think you're the most beautiful woman in the world. I want you to be my wife, and will you marry me?
Of course.
During Austin's frequent visits, we grew to trust him as he shared in our dreams.
No. Nice agua, amigo. Agua ardiente.
Tejas continued to attract new settlers. Soon they were calling themselves Texians. In some cases, their fame preceded them.
I've been told that a tired traveler is never turned away from Casablanca.
Pienso que es Jim Bowie.
Jim Bowie? Jim Bowie and Esteban Austin were men who respected our culture, our traditions, who spoke our language, men with whom I became close friends. But as more and more Americanos came to our land, the Mexican government became alarmed and in 1830 passed a law. This much desired frontier would no longer be open to Americano settlers. Outraged, the Americanos, led by Sam Houston, threatened to secede entirely from Mexico. They wanted to create a separate country that they felt was their manifest destiny to own. To calm the Americanos, Esteban Austin went to Presidente Santana to petition for repeal of the law. The law was soon repealed, but not without cost to my friend.
My dear Don Erasmo, I write to you on the 28th day of my incarceration in Mexico City.
I languish now in this jail cell at the capital, unsure of my fate. I ask that you not allow my incarceration to despoil the victory we have won with the repeal of the law of April 6, 1830. I repeat, gentlemen, the victory we have won. As always, my warmest regard to you, to Juan, and to your family. Esteban Austin.
Well, what are we going to do? Just let him rot in jail?
The ayuntamiento must take this up. If you hadn't sent that copy of Austin's letter to the capital, he wouldn't have been arrested.
I must caution patience here, gentlemen. You have heard what Esteban has written to us. He himself sees that we can easily lose what we have gained if we take hasty action. Our cotton industry, the new settlements, the development of Texas itself is at stake. And I'm not about to jeopardize all of this for Austin.
Forgive me, Don Ramon. You mistake my point. A friend of all of ours. He's in jail. And why? Because you, Don Ramon, informed on him.
I acted responsibly in my role as jefe político. Don Gaspar, as alcalde of San Antonio, and myself, we are still loyal Mexicans. And until we are given permission by the state legislature to hold a convention, we shall not do so.
And I, for one, will report any and all seditious activities of these Americanos.
I agree.
Or their friends.
Listen to me, Juan. I must agree with Don Ramon and young Francisco here. We must do things legally. If we allow any further insurrection at this time, we lose all opportunity to become a state for the Mexican Republic.
Now is not the time to provoke the government.
Perdón, Don Erasmo. But they're the ones who are provoking us.
Indeed. The colonists have every right to complain. We don't even have local rule. We have to send to Saltillo for permission to do anything.
And that's a month away.
Juan Seguin.
Don Gaspar.
If representation is your problem, perhaps you should take a more active part in your own local government, young man.
If your Americano friends don't like it here, why don't they go back to where they came from?
Francisco, that's enough!
Is it because they're waiting for the right time? The right time to steal more lands? Look how their numbers have grown in the past 10 years. We're already outnumbered 5-1.
Perhaps I will take a more active role than Gaspar. Since it appears that some of you are so fearful of the Americanos that you forget. We invited them here. It is they who are helping to build Tejas. And I, for one, welcome the help.
Gentlemen, you'll excuse me.
Both of our fathers are bowing to the pressure.
They have to come around to our point of view sooner or later.
What?
Go on.
I'm ashamed of your behavior in there. Those men are our neighbors and powerful.
You're not to be made fun of, my son.
As long as Austin is in jail, the war party will have an excuse to call for independence. Don't you see that? By remaining silent, those fools in there only make matters worse.
You don't think I feel for Austin.
What are you doing about it?
It's so easy for you, Juan. Brash actions will take care of everything. Well, no, my son. We must adhere to the law.
Juanito, listen to me. I want Texas as a state of Mexico as much as you do. But we must obey the law.
We cannot play into their hands.
Besides, there are the people at stake here. Need I remind you that rebellion now will not only affect Americanos, but Mexicano families as well.
But the Tejano families will join us.
Hombre, no. Not now. You saw that yourself in there. They're afraid. Hijo, when you are able to convince other Tejanos here to join us, then I will follow you. Until then, Juan, we do things my way.
Amid the turmoil of politics in Texas, Houston's war party, and Austin's imprisonment, we faced yet another calamity. Cholera struck San Antonio in the summer of 1834.
No.
Although our daughters, Teresa and Antonia, had survived, my son succumbed to the fever.
A letter. Your friend, Jim Bowie.
My dear Juan, the Mexican president Antonio Lopez de Santana has declared for a centralist government in Mexico.
What is it?
Although it may mean war, Don Martin and myself pledge our support to you and the other families of San Antonio. Texas must become a state or break away entirely from Mexico.
War. Is he serious?
This is exactly what Sam Houston and his war party have been waiting for.
We can't fight against Mexico. Our own people.
We'll have to fight. On one side or the other.
Levántese, estás libre.
Santana released Austin in August of 1835, but threatened military action if the Texians continued in their opposition.
Oh,
Santana warned me. If we hold a state convention, you will consider it an act of war. That is why this army he sends here is only to remind us of this.
How much time do you think that we have?
6 months. A year. We need time. If there is to be war, we must raise an army. We must go to Washington. We have friends there. We must call for volunteers. I believe there are many men who would be willing to fight Santana.
I don't know, Estelle. I worry about more Americanos. Please tell me, can you control your people?
With war now inevitable, Austin recruited my help for the defense of San Antonio.
Juan, I'm personally proud of you. That's why I'm commissioning you, Captain in the Texas Volunteer Army, just under Jim Bowie and Colonel Travis.
General Castrillon.
Several hundred men in the snow. Now this infernal heat. You and half of the army are down with a fever. And we must move on tomorrow.
As long as I am, I... As good as dead.
In January of 1836, Santana's army crossed the Rio Grande. General Santana had declared that property belonging to what he labeled traitorous Tejano families was to be confiscated. We had no choice now but to defend our homes. What we feared most was upon us. Support of Chris Arrocha, I set about to recruit a company of Tejano volunteers, or as we soon became known, Leoncitos, the Young Lions. Became a supply center for the Texas defenders. And in San Antonio, fortifications were built around an old church, the Alamo.
there within a morning's ride from San Antonio. They know we're here.
How many are there?
200, perhaps.
200. And the Tejanos?
The Flores family. The Seguins. The Navarros. They're all with the Norteamericanos.
They'll pay for that.
Outnumbered 20 to 1, we were surrounded by Santana's army. Our defense of the Alamo seemed hopeless.
We're on the wrong side.
You've seen the red flag over the church. Santana will kill us all if we surrender.
There is no other side.
What about your brother, Gregorio?
Francisco chose his side and we chose ours.
As for me, I'm Tejano first. Brother or no brother.
Colonel Fannin has 400 men on Coleto Creek. You must bring as many here as possible. And after you've seen Fannin, get this to Houston at Gonzales.
Manuel Flores has been recruiting volunteers also.
There's more to brotherhood than blood. Francisco's always been afraid to risk anything. You know he's always wanted to be on the winning side. Well, he'll soon get that chance. Cruz, how do we get to this?
Cruz? Cruz?
We've got some mail to deliver for Bowie.
To make it.
Alto!
Sorry.
It's that dream again.
6 years. It keeps coming back.
Juan, you did your best.
Austin had died, but our vision of a new society was becoming a reality. San Antonio was now part of the Lone Star Republic.
a new country. For us, it was a time of prosperity. My father had been elected postmaster, and I had been elected mayor. Our second son, Jose Erasmo, was now 7. We were proud of what we would one day bequeath our children.
I ordered that calico a month ago.
Not everyone shared in our dream for Tejas.
You get out of my store! Both of you, just get out of my store and don't come back!
I never felt so humiliated in all my life. It was as if I was a stranger in town instead of him.
To this, I'm sorry that it happened. I'm sure he didn't know who you were.
Oh, that he did. He knew I was Mexican, and that was enough. That was all he needed to know.
But I'm sure if he'd known you were the mayor's wife...
Juan, what are you saying? Are you saying that it's all right for him to treat any other Tejano like that?
That's not what I meant. Now, I will speak to the man tomorrow. But you know we must be patient with these Americanos. It's up to us to set an example, to show them we can live together.
But how can we, when they consider themselves so much better than us? My father settled this valley, and so did yours. And now these Americanos arrive, and they act as if we're the ones that don't belong. And you, instead of defending me, you're defending them.
I'm not defending them. I'm not. I'm the mayor. I have a responsibility to the community. I'm sorry, sometimes it goes beyond my responsibility to you, to my family, to myself. I admit there are bad Americanos, I don't deny it. But there are also men like Austin, men who try.
Austin is dead.
I ain't taking no orders from no Mexican, and that means you, Seguin.
Mr. Goodman, I am the mayor of this town.
You ain't sh-
I have been ordered by the town council to ask you to leave these premises. This building belongs to the city of San Antonio.
The hell it do! Where's Lamar Silk give this to me on account of horses I shot for him during the war?
That's all fine and good, sir. However, President Lamar had no authority to do so, and as mayor... Drop it. That's better. Now you be out of here by next week, or I'll be throwing you out.
You win right now, Ski. But you mark my words. I'm gonna get you for this.
San Antonio was dividing into factions, and I was caught in the middle. When troops of the Mexican army raided our city, the already hostile Americanos held me responsible.
Are any concern of yours?
Now, Gilbo, we don't got no beef with you. You just let Seguin come on out, we'll be on our way.
My guests have the protection of my house.
All right, Seguin, we come for you. I told you I'd get you.
Well, I can see we're about evenly matched, Mr. Goodman.
We're gonna string you up.
Over him, Goodman!
take him, Goodman.
You'll be the first to go.
Don't shoot. Don't anybody shoot.
Mayor Seguin, I suggest you take your leave now.
Thank you, Mr. Gilbo. As you know, there have been several attempts on my life. Today we received this letter. Will you read it?
We've had enough of your treachery. If we catch any Seguin within a mile of San Antonio, we'll stretch their neck from the nearest tree.
Papa.
Seguin were out to kill you. Texas for Texans.
We cannot go on like this.
Maybe we can go someplace for a while. Until things settle down.
But where, Trudy? If we can't get protection here in San Antonio, where people know us, what will happen in Nacogdoches or New Orleans, where all they've heard are these rumors?
Don Erasmo is right. We cannot go east or to the north because the Americanos will know we're coming.
But do we want to leave?
I don't think we have a choice.
Our dream for Texas died with our friend Austin. At least your mother was spared all of this. May she rest in peace. Juan, you must go to Laredo.
To Mexico?
Yes.
To Santana? That's madness.
Perhaps. But if you stay here, it is certain death for you. Remember what the man said. Texas. For Texans.
But Father, what about you?
Memories here. I must stay.
You were right all along. They don't respect us. They never have. We're Mexicanos. They think we're inferior. All my life, I believed in a dream. And in the end, that's all it was, a dream. A myth. The idea that we could all live together as equals.
through this, I'd bet my friends' lives on it. I led Gregorio Esparza into the Alamo, and I left him there to die. For what? A dream. How could I have been so blind? I thought we were fighting for Tejas, for our homeland. To make a place for our families. But it was only to make a place for the people who hate us. Oh. Thank God I'm finally too old to dream.
You are your dreams.
No more. No more. I want to kill. I want to get back at them for all the things they've done to us. I want revenge.
That's not enough. How do you think I feel? Do you think you're the only one that's been betrayed? I'll not have them destroy you. And I will not have you destroy yourself.
I so love you.
We were adrift, no longer knowing where to pay our allegiance. Then the inevitable, war between the United States and Mexico. I was torn between two loyalties. We chose to serve in Santana's army. Cruz and I found ourselves fighting against old Tejano neighbors. Regardless of which side won the war, we would be the losers. Bruce and I were not the only ones to suffer.
They're not coming. Ten months and the war isn't over, and then not coming.
Finally, the war was over. The bitterness I felt for the Americanos seemed useless. I was tired and had seen too much death on both sides. Changed me. I realized how idealistic we had been in those early years.
Tejas.
Our people had lost not just their dream of Tejas for Tejanos, but the Americanos had lost their chance for a just society. I knew I would never again be so naive. Yet I was determined not to weep over past defeats. My fight was not over. Not until we could assure a future for our children and their descendants.
In 1849, I was given a pardon by the United States government. My contributions to the growth of Texas had been recognized. It was time to go home. Is that you? We're home. We're home to stay.
Stay tuned for an unusual look at individualism on Paradox on 72nd Street at 1130 C. Picasso and at midnight, the captioned evening news.